Bristol Myers Four Star Playhouse presents Dick Powell, Charles Boyer, David Niven, Joan Fontaine.
My name is Wycliffe.
I saw you coming up from the steamer. What can I do for you?
I thought the governor... You are the controller, are you not?
Official representative of civilization on this benighted island.
Didn't the governor general write to you about me?
You're too fast for this climate. Faster than my native assistant. You arrived before my mail. It is coffee time. Will you join me?
I'd like to join you very much, but I don't have long. I want to catch the steamer before she turns around. I need your help.
You have it. As long as it doesn't mean my keeping pace with you. Please sit down.
This is a matter of some urgency, Controller. I'm here to find a murderer.
You have to go farther up the river. There are no killings here anymore. They're Dayaks. Do not go headhunting any longer.
No, I'm not looking for a native headhunter. The man I want is an American. His name is Jerome Steeks. He's on this island.
Steeks? Never heard the name.
I hardly thought he would still be using his own name. He's also known as James Stanley, among other things.
No one by that name either.
Well, let's approach it from this angle, then. Has any American arrived lately on this island? If he has, what does he call himself, and where can I find him?
Well, it's not so simple. Sugar?
No, thank you.
There are three Americans here. All three arrived about 4 months ago.
Where are they?
They're on the Cotobaru estate, rubber estate, an hour from here. Obviously, you can't make the steamer. Let me fetch your luggage. You can stay with me.
All right, thank you very much.
Oh, not a bit.
These three Americans all arriving together is rather odd, don't you think?
No, not at all. The Cotobaru estate changed hands. And the new company, obviously, wants Americans to run it.
Do you know these men yourself?
I see them occasionally. What is the man like you're looking for?
He's a man of cultivated taste. He's a connoisseur of wine, women, and music. He speaks French fluently. He's a gambler and extremely dangerous. As to his appearance, I just have a description to go on, that's all. He's tall, very fair-haired, moustache, rather heavy.
I mean, with jowls and a paunch like me.
Well, let's say he's comfortably covered.
Well, Mr. Wycliffe, I would like to have you as my guest. But perhaps you better catch the steamer after all. All three Americans are tall. But they're dark-haired, clean-shaven, and not a pound of fat among them.
Well, it's no great trick for a man to dye his hair and lose a little weight. And there are no other Americans on the island?
No one has come to the island since the plantation changed hands. Governor General's letter. Excuse me. I see. You're on official business. May I ask you who this man murdered?
His wife, for rather sordid reasons.
I see. And you think it is possible that this man is one of the three Americans in spite of what I tell you?
There is no question about it.
This man has never seen you before?
No.
Well, in that case, I better send a runner down to the plantation with word that we are coming down for lunch tomorrow at noon.
Fine.
I will introduce you as my friend, Dick Wilson. Does this name suit you? You will look them over and then decide for yourself.
It may take more than just a casual meeting at lunch for me to pick out my man, particularly if he's altered as much as he has. I must have time to study him for several days, if necessary. Maybe I could say I was a stockholder of the company, that I was traveling around these parts and I wanted to see how the plantation was being run.
Well, you think it is safe if this man is dangerous?
Sometimes, Controller, one must just trust to luck.
Here comes the Dutchman with his stockholder friend.
Stockholder, huh? Well, this should be very interesting.
Good morning, gentlemen.
Hello, Controller.
May I present Mr. Wilson, Mr. Morgan, Mr. Fisher?
How do you do?
How are you? How do you do?
Where's Stevens?
He'll be right here. He's over at the chemical shack.
Want a drink?
A little later, I think. Do you fellas mind if I stick around for a while? I won't be in your way.
Sure.
I've always wanted to find out how you made a dozen golf balls or a set of pneumatic tires out of a tree.
Nothing to it. Here comes Stevens now.
Never late for a meal.
Mr. Stevens, Mr. Wilson,
our stockholder. How do you do?
How are you?
That last batch didn't test out so good. Let's eat.
Sort of a spot, you can't expect fancy grub. And I'm getting awful sick of rice stuffle.
It's always been a mystery to me why men choose to live their lives in this part of the world. The climate's appalling, the food is uninspired, and the mosquitoes.
Maybe they don't choose.
Well, the East gets in your blood, unfortunately.
That's your trouble, Fisher?
What do you mean, my trouble?
You said that maybe some people don't choose to live here. Do you have the East in your blood?
No, I don't. I wasn't talking about myself.
Who were you talking about?
Nobody in particular. You know just as well as I do, there's plenty of people who live out here because Borneo is about as far from civilization as they can get.
What do you fellows do for recreation here?
Sleep, mainly, and drink, with an occasional trip to Batavia.
We play a little pinochle, me and Morgan. Stephen doesn't play cards.
Never could get interested.
Then you must be the reader of the party.
Why do you say that?
Oh, I noticed about a collection of books.
Fat lot of good they'll do Stevens. All in French.
Any of us, for that matter. The legacy from the previous owner of the place.
Let's have some music, huh?
Another bottle of beer?
No, thanks.
Too warm, huh?
Well, I found some excellent wine in Batavia the other day. Quite inexpensive, too. You ought to send me some. After all, it's better to drink warm red wine than warm beer.
You're a wine expert, which I'm not.
Fisher's the wine expert, he says.
Who said anything about being an expert? When I want to show a girl a big time, I splurge on a bottle of champagne.
Is that the best you can do?
Well, thank you, gentlemen. But I must return to pressing official business.
The controller will now go and pound his official ear.
Correct. You're going to stay here overnight?
Well, I'd very much like to. It's not too inconvenient. I've never been on a plantation before. I'd like to stay and have a look around.
Why not? You're a stockholder.
So you want to stay?
More than ever.
Still convinced?
Baffled, but still convinced.
Well, you're taking a grave risk. These men were not themselves today. A certain hostility.
Yes, I felt they were on edge, and that makes me more certain than ever that one of them is Steaks.
But which one?
Well, frankly, at the moment, I haven't the faintest idea. When I can be sure that Stevens, for instance, is not a card player, that Morgan is not a wine drinker, and find out why Fisher lives here against his wishes, then I shall be near a solution. the moment, the thing that really interests me is which of the three has a bottle of hair dye?
Well, I must be going.
Please be careful. I don't want a murdered friend of the Governor General in my district.
Don't worry, I shall take all precautions to see that your records are unimpaired. What's this one?
Another coagulant, formic acid.
Oh, it stings.
Not surprising. Used to be prepared by distilling red ants. This is acetic acid, and this is sodium silicofluoride, which about covers the 50-cent tour.
Well, I hope I haven't been too much of a nuisance. I say, I should never feel quite the same about wearing a raincoat again. Red ants, indeed.
Did you find out what you came for?
Yes, I did indeed. And very interesting, too.
What exactly did you come to find out?
No one thing in particular. I just wanted to get an overall impression of how the plantation was being run.
No, that's not what I meant.
No?
Fisher means when you were searching our room this afternoon.
I see.
The stockholder story won't do, Wilson. We knew you were a fraud before you got here. You see, there are no stockholders in this company.
We're the company, if you want to know.
I hope you keep on finding it that funny, Wilson. We don't.
Let's have it, Wilson, if that's your name.
No, as a matter of fact, it's not. And you're quite right, I do owe you an apology and an explanation.
Make it good.
I'll let you gentlemen be the judge of that. The reason I came here was because I wanted to find out which one of you three is a murderer.
And which one of us is the murderer?
Not one of you, I'm happy to say.
You said something about an explanation, Wilson.
Right, and it's about time.
Sure. Tell us, friend. Who murdered who?
The man I'm looking for murdered his wife.
That's excusable sometimes. Why did he do it?
For money.
That makes sense.
He thought it did. The amount involved was considerable.
Like how much?
Like $250,000.
Quite a hunk. I'd have murdered mine for much less if I'd lived with her any longer.
Shut up!
Then what happened?
Well, he was a very clever fellow. He was a big gambler. Apparently, he started off by getting his wife to believe that he'd been losing money consistently, as he needed a large sum to cover his losses. She was infatuated by him, so she gave him everything he asked for. She even liquidated some assets against the advice of her attorney. But then he told her that he used an assumed name for these gambling activities. And the checks that she gave him, therefore, were made out in the name of James Stanley. Then he opened an account at a small bank in a small town. And when he'd taken everything from her that he dared to take, he killed her. The way he did that was neat, too. He wrote a suicide pact, signed his name, and forged hers. And a few days later, her body was washed up on the beach. His was never found. The assumption is that he sailed that same day for France.
Whose assumption?
Mine.
That's quite a story.
How do you know he didn't kill himself, too? That's right. Just because his body wasn't found doesn't mean to say that he didn't commit suicide, does it?
By itself, no, of course it doesn't. But her family always had the gravest doubts whether she, of all people, could ever have committed suicide. Her religion, her whole nature, everything was against it. And then, just a few months ago, their suspicions were confirmed in a most unexpected way.
It always is in this sort of a yarn.
Shut up, Fisher. Go on, Wilson.
How did they find out?
Well, as luck would have it, this small bank where he had deposited the money failed and went into receivership. May I? His account was, of course, impounded along with all the others. Then about this time, a letter arrived at the bank from this James Stanley in Batavia, requesting that his entire account should be transferred to the Royal Netherlands Bank there. This letter, of course, was placed in the hands of the officials who were investigating the bank's affairs. And it wasn't very long before it was established beyond question who this James Stanley really was. His trail has led right here.
What are you, an insurance investigator?
No, just an ordinary police inspector. Well, gentlemen, that's the story. I'm sure you will forgive my subterfuge and bear me no ill will. When the steamer arrives next week, I shall be on my way, and I shall continue my search for this man.
What's his name? His real name, I mean.
Jerome Steeks, S-T-E-E-K-S.
Odd name.
Or fictitious.
And what's yours?
Wycliffe. Well, that's the story. I don't see why I should be in your way here any longer. So if one of you will be good enough to drop me down to the town, I'll wait there for the steamer.
I'll take you.
Thank you.
You're welcome to stay as long as you like, now that we know who you are and why you're here.
No, thank you, Morgan. I've rather lost my interest in rubber. And I know you'll understand when I say that Controller Kurtz's cook is rather more resourceful than the old man here.
That wouldn't be difficult.
Yes, rice staple does get rather boring. That gives me an idea. I really would like to repay your hospitality. So why don't you try and get through early on the day the steamer comes in, and we'll have a really good dinner at the controller's place. The captain of the Van Laar has some excellent wine on board. I'll invite him to and tell him to bring a few bottles. How's that?
Suits me.
Me too.
Sounds great.
Fine. Maybe we could get hold of a pig for the occasion. Don't you have some wild boar around these parts?
Why don't we get up a shoot?
I guess you shoot, don't you?
Sometimes, when I have to. Would somebody lend me a gun?
Have one of mine. I've got a couple.
Thank you. Well, gentlemen, good hunting to all of us.
This is suicide.
I hope not, Controller.
I hope not, I hope not. For 12 years, I hoped for a promotion, and now you come into my district to commit suicide.
I shall do everything I can to guard against this stigma to your career. Now, what I'm trying to do is to force our man into making a move against me. That's why I told them all the story in such detail. That's why I've arranged the boar hunt to give him a chance to do so.
But you gamble with your life and my promotion that you duck in time to see who is shooting at you.
Now, what I'm really afraid of is that he will be too smart to try anything.
So?
So, to guard against that eventuality, I've arranged the dinner party. I have a little something up my sleeve.
I hope it is a revolver.
No, it's a little more subtle than that.
I don't suppose you've ever hunted pig before.
No, birds have been about my limit.
Don't worry. The boy here will look out for you.
Is he an expert?
He was an expert headhunter once, but he tells us he reformed.
Oh, that's a relief. Now, about these pig, how does one...
You don't even have to go after them here. Once the boys have set one moving, he's after you, and you'd better be fast.
They cannot run anything on four legs in this terrain.
They found. We better spread out. And if you miss him, jump for a tree.
Right.
Our own house boy.
Who got him?
I guess I did.
I guess we both did.
Probably trying to impress a girl with your distinguished head, Wycliffe. They still try it occasionally.
A sort of a hobby with them, you know. When there's an hour in the month, I suppose.
And with all of that, did anyone get a pig?
Two.
And one long one.
No, I didn't. One of them had put a native boy after throwing a spear at me. Luckily, the spear missed, and the boy was promptly shot.
Uh-huh. The one who shot must be your man.
Unfortunately, two of them shot at exactly the same time, Morgan and Stevens both.
How about the third one? Fisher, wasn't it?
If he's our man, he might have been smart enough to hold his fire so that the others did the dirty work for him.
Then you don't follow as you were before.
At the moment, no, I'm not. But I have high hopes for our dinner party. There we are.
Well, if I drink any more, I won't be able to enjoy the food.
Let's change the diet.
Well, dish it out.
Well, we have to thank Captain Van Schell for this delicious pâté and for the Bordeaux.
Yeah.
Aubryon 34, a great wine. Don't you agree, Captain?
Beautiful, beautiful. This gentleman knows about wine. Most people I meet on my ship know nothing but whiskey soda.
Or gin per heads. What's wrong with whiskey?
Oh, any trouble is that once you've drunk it, there's nothing left to talk about. Ah, magnificent. Magnificent. I tell the story of the Frenchman who invited an American to dinner. The Frenchman was something of a gourmet, so he opened one of his more precious vintages and filled a couple of glasses. Then he proposed a toast to the American. The American acknowledged the toast and started to drink. But the Frenchman stopped him and he said, "Oh, no, monsieur. No true lover of wine ever acknowledges a toast like that." The American asked what he'd done wrong. And the Frenchman said, "Well, first you lift your glass and you admire the beautiful color. Then you savor the bouquet of the wine." By this time, the American was getting impatient, and he said, "And now do you start to drink?" "Not yet," said the Frenchman. "First, you talk about it."
After all that, let's have the stuff.
Yes, of course. But, first of all, allow me to ice it for you.
Don't put ice in that!
Oh, you're quite right, of course. I just thought that it might make a nice change from all those warm drinks you keep on complaining about. Mr. Steaks?
Have you gone mad?
What kind of a game is this?
Tell me something, Steaks. How do you keep your hair dark without using dye?
What are you talking about?
You know what I'm talking about. You said you didn't know anything about wine, and when I began to ice that...
You're too clever, Wycliffe! Steaks, stop it!
Come back here.
I should have killed you myself instead of putting the native boy up to it.
You're right. I still want to know about your hair.
You're a smart fellow. I thought you could have figured that out by yourself. My hair has always been dark brown. When I began living by my wits, I knew I'd have to hide out someday, so I bleached it light and kept it that way, knowing I could grow it back whenever I wanted to. I've answered your question. Now answer one for me.
Sure, what is it?
When did you first find out?
Just now, really.
Just now?
Yes. I took a gamble on the wine and on the ice. I didn't really know until just now, when you were good enough to tell me.